Hey, what is up, guys? MKBHD here. This is a Samsung Galaxy S10, and this is the phone to beat for 2019. And not only is the phone great, but it's positioned so perfectly at the beginning of this year. So the Galaxy S series in general, which I think has been overshadowed by the Galaxy Note usually every year, has really found its groove with the Galaxy S10. This phone is basically the most complete all-around phone you can buy, which is why I say it sets the bar. This is the phone you have to beat if you want to be considered the best this year. So the big new changes or things to know with the S10 are in specs, design, and cameras. Those are the main things. The design is the biggest new change on the S10. It's the most recognizable new design in a phone in a little while. And I'd say aesthetically, there are very few downsides, but there are a few. So when you get it out the box, it's of course dominated by this huge, beautiful, bright display. And I'm reviewing the S10 Plus, so it's an even bigger and more beautiful screen. Super viewable outdoors, great colors and calibration, thin bezels all the way around, thin chin, thin forehead, and I made an entire video all about the display actually that I'll link below if you want to watch that. My couple of downsides pretty much feel like nitpicking at this point. Like I have the occasional accidental screen press from the Infinity Edge display somewhere that I found a little bit annoying, and the power button on the right hand side is definitely annoyingly high up. I wish it was lower. And also, it looks like every single reviewer got this white Galaxy S10 Plus, which has like this iridescent pearl color changing finish. It's kind of trippy. A lot of people like it. I don't know. I really don't think I like it as much. I much prefer something a bit cleaner, a bit stealthier, really. There are other colors available too, or you could grab a skin from our channel sponsor, Dbrand, plus you get the added bonus of never having to wipe fingerprints off the back again. So I don't know. Maybe it's just me. I'll link it below if you're interested in that stealth look. But the body of the phone itself is, of course, glass and metal, but it's somehow a super lightweight phone. Like, it really looks like it should be heavier than it is, but it's super light in the hand. I wish I got to hold the ceramic version because I assume that would feel more substantial in the hand, but that's not even a complaint. That's just something I noticed. Okay, so lots of thoughts on this whole punch-out, cutout display that they have on all these phones. S10 Plus with the dual camera cutout, S10 and S10e with the single camera cutout. By the way, full review on the S10e is gonna be separate. But I have this theory on why I've actually ended up liking the hole punch cutout more than a notch. So I kind of started off feeling the same way about it as a notch. I even called it a glorified notch, basically. I didn't feel any different. I was looking it up and I kind of didn't really find a name for it, but you know the cognitive effect where you can be missing a bit of information in a photo or video, but because of the information that surrounds it, your brain kind of fills in what was supposed to be there, sort of subconsciously, like that. I think that's what's happening with the hole punch cutout. Like, my brain was already totally used to seeing notches in phones just because the past couple years of phones kind of all had them, but there's something about having just a little bit of extra pixels on the top and to the side of the notch that made it easier to forget about. Hopefully that makes sense. But also the hole punch, it really gets in the way of anything. It's not blocking any controls in games or apps or anything important in videos or anything like that. It's small enough that it fits essentially in the notification bar at the top, albeit it's a little bit taller. But basically I'm in the camp that this ends up feeling better than the notch. You can fight me if you disagree. Also, I have an update to the glass screen protector situation with the ultrasonic fingerprint reader. So I did that video about the display where I tested a regular fingerprint reader. It worked, as you can imagine. And a glass fingerprint reader did not work. Then everyone started sending me links to this white stone dome tempered glass screen protector with a very unique, like 20 minute long install process. But I installed it, and despite my imperfect install, it definitely did work. So if you're interested in using a tempered glass screen protector and the ultrasonic fingerprint reader on the Galaxy S10, that one does work. I'll link it below, of course, as well. I also installed it on Instagram Live. It took me like half an hour. It was kind of hilarious, but hey, it worked. So specs, you don't really have to worry about specs with the Galaxy S10. The specs are great. Snapdragon 855, 8 gigs of RAM, plenty of storage, and performance, of course, will fall in line with that. And this is a very smooth phone throughout my time using it, which it should be in the first 2 weeks. The one new spec to note is the battery. The batteries are bigger, and I gotta say, the 4100 milliamp hour battery on this S10 Plus has been excellent. I've regularly gotten 5+ hours of screen on time with this huge screen, which is super impressive. The other day I had a light day of use and I had 7 hours of screen on time with 15% left. So not quite the full 2-day weekend phone that the Mate 20 Pro, our battery champ, could be, but pretty damn good for one day for a huge screen like this. And of course you also have fast charging and wireless charging. And speaking of wireless charging, you also have reverse wireless charging, which is pretty cool. I mean, it's still kind of a gimmick. It's super slow. It's at 4.5 watts. And for context, a normal Qi wireless charger is usually up to 9 or 10 watts, usually more. The slow charger that comes with the iPhone is 5 watts. So it's not something you'd use every day. It's obviously really slow, but it's more useful for charging small things like the Galaxy Buds, or even like a Qi-enabled smartwatch or something like that with a much smaller battery. It'll also be cool for when Apple reinvents it for the AirPods too. And then, of course, you can't forget about the new cameras on Galaxy S10. And by new, I mean really just the ultra-wide camera is new, and the other two cameras are essentially the same as last year, which is to say firmly third place or so on my chart for best overall image quality that would be behind the Pixel and the iPhone. The standard camera is still really good, especially when you give it enough light. It handles colors and high dynamic range better than ever thanks to software. But really, you're looking at essentially the same tech, the dual aperture main camera with OIS, the second telephoto camera that you'll almost never use, but hey, it's there if you need it. And then the standard characteristics of photos from the Galaxy S10 are sharp, pretty colorful, evenly lit, not a ton of contrast, but still vibrant and a little overexposed. It just seems like if it ever errs on anything, it's with overexposure. It would much rather blow out highlights and evenly light people and subjects than lose anything to shadows. But the ultra-wide camera is the most fun addition by far. It doesn't have OIS, but you hardly need it at this focal length. And I've been waiting for something fun and new like this to bring a new perspective, especially to more abstract photos or architecture photos. The distortion can get a little much if you're trying to do subjects and people with this ultra-wide shot, but overall, you're usually much more in it for the unique look than the portrait, and that it delivers. So yeah, a super wide-angle camera like this, it already has software stabilization. It's also already a waterproof phone. I feel like with a good enough ruggedized case, this could basically replace a GoPro. Just throwing that out there. So yeah, I'm glad Samsung added this. The S10e also has the ultra-wide camera as well. And Apple will probably toss it in the next iPhone too, so thumbs up for that. Also, the front-facing camera is even more of that. So there's a front-facing wide-angle camera like I mentioned, and on the S10 Plus, a second cutout for a depth sensor. As a result, the front-facing selfies from the S10 Plus are pretty good. They don't strike me as way better than the S10 or the Pixel or others. It still draws a depth map that can fail sometimes, and it still overexposes also all the time. But overall, the selfie camera is a B+. I still wish there was a second ultra-wide camera though. That would have been sweet. Also, I gotta say, I wish there was a dedicated night mode in this camera. It doesn't really have one, kind of like something like Night Sight or what Huawei has done with their night cameras. And even when you do have it turned on, it's basically in the scene recognition in the AI, so it'll recognize when it's dark enough, but even that doesn't make as big of a difference as Night Sight, so I kind of wish there was a dedicated mode. But hey, maybe they could add that with a software update. But speaking of software updates, you can now remap the Bixby button to do anything you want. Almost. Kinda. I mean, there's kind of a huge catch. I mean, Bixby still isn't very good, but in the Bixby settings, you can now single press or double press the Bixby button to launch whatever app you want, as long as the other still launches Bixby. Oh, and by the way, the whole whatever you want thing doesn't include other voice assistants. So anything you want except other voice assistants. So yeah, you can, I don't know, you can kind of hide it behind a double press. You probably won't accidentally double press it very often. So, you know what? I'll say it's a step in the right direction. Being able to do that better than you could before. And that step in the right direction kind of isn't the theme of the rest of One UI. It's a step forward. This is the first version of a Samsung Android overlay that I've actually stuck with the stock launcher and used it. You know, typically I will switch over to Nova Launcher pretty quick, but One UI is different, and that says something about the direction they're going. It's pretty smooth overall, and of course the icons, which were sort of cartoony and huge on the stock grid, are actually customizable, so I feel like I've kind of had my way with it and I've gotten used to it. Now, I still don't know about version updates in the future. It's Android P out the box, so fingers crossed Samsung is also turning over a new leaf with software updates, but that's the sort of thing we'll have to wait and see. Overall though, I give it a thumbs up. It's not too overly colorful. There is a dark mode, which is cool. And the theme of keeping everything pretty low on the screen so it's easily accessible with one hand is really smart, with especially how tall these displays have gotten. So on top of all of that, add IP68 water resistance, like usual, add Wi-Fi 6, expandable storage, a headphone jack. Like, it's just really super complete. There's so many little things on top of the already solid core experience that, I spent $1,000 on a Galaxy S10 Plus of my own, and I really think this is one of the few phones that actually feels like it's worth it. Like, even if you want to judge it by the five pillars of a great smartphone, you already have, you know, the build quality is sort of timeless. We've seen it before. The battery life is excellent. The performance is really good. The cameras are nice. And the display is best in class. It's got them all on lock. The bar has been set, and it's been set pretty high. Until the next one, thanks for watching. Catch you guys later. Peace.